So there's many things that I want to talk about and many things that I want to ask you. But the first thing that I'm duty bound to ask you because of your work, because of your concerns, but also because of today. So today is the 21st of January, and all across the world there are demonstrations and marches around the rights of women and respect for women. So I first want to ask you about women. And very, very specifically, the way that you have worked with writing about women in your, I won't say in your literature project, if you will allow me, The Crystal Frontier, which you began working on in 1998. And for those who haven't read it, you must, because it's great. It's a collection of fragments that veer from a classic narrative to lists of daily activities, to potential plays, to potential gatherings, to potential instructions, to thoughts, to diary entries. But this is a really important part, I believe, in Maitu's work, because it forms the ground from which a lot of the work departs. So could you just talk a little bit about specifically women in The Crystal Frontier?
So the, in case you don't all know, because I don't know if everybody knows, the Crystal Frontier is a narrative I started in 1999, and it coincided with the beginning of my artistic, public artistic practice. So I began showing work, and I began The Crystal Frontier at the same time. There is no exhibited work before. It was the sort of founding gesture for my work. And it's the story of a group of women, date unspecified, place unspecified, who leave a big city, a city like London or a city like New York, frustrated by everyday life, having jobs, the patriarchy, just frustrated with modern life, and create a commune in the desert in New Mexico. And it's on purpose left it very unclear mm-hmm. when it was happening, if it was the past or if it was the future, and if it was, real or unreal, because it was modeled after a lot of things that had existed. And I devised it a bit like a kind of, let's say an archaeologist finds little leaflets or handbills or things like traces left over from a distant civilization. So the idea was you could piece back together the life of these people from these pieces of text. And as you pointed out, the commune is fairly remarkable because it's only women. And I guess my point wasn't, I was interested in creating an inversion of the regular order. So mm-hmm. in a way, women wasn't even just about like females or female bodies or anything that I would say essentialist or limiting. It was more, the world today is not run by women, as we've just, as we keep on being reminded. And so what if we made a story where we inverted the situation and women were left free to sort of create their own world? And it's not a story where everything is easy. It's mm-hmm. it's the story of the sort of also idealist struggle, mm-hmm. I guess. Mm-hmm. So that's, I guess, the point, where I started with this this woman thing. But it was always sort of a big question for me. Mm-hmm. Also how, as a female, as a woman, as an artist, you sort of take a place in the history and the discourse, which was dominantly male until quite mm-hmm. recently. So these were mm-hmm. things that I wanted to deal with, and that's sort of how I put it in.
But it's also very much a narrative. A narrative is something that I think speaks very, very loudly in your work, but it's not a narrative that tells you a given story. It seems to me that your work operates in a very particular intellectual universe that's constantly bringing things from other sources.
Yeah.
We don't need them to be footnoted, and if we did, it would be a display rather than an investigation. Could you talk a little bit about how you approach making work, how you do research?
I think what it is that So ideas or interests or figures sort of dovetail into each other, mm-hmm. and then it becomes a work. So for example, in this show, there was when I started making the work for The Gnasher, which this exhibition in a way is a continuation of. I had this idea that I wanted to make sculptures again, and I wanted to make sculptures of female figures, like pieces I had made about 10 years ago and continued making. And then I had this fixation on the YPJs, the female, the Kurdish protection units in Syria. And then I had the fact that I discovered Monique Wittig, this French feminist writer, mm-hmm. From the 60s and 70s, who wrote a book called Les Guerrières that's about a female army sort of taking over the world. And these things kind of, to me, it seemed that these things kind of meshed, mm-hmm. but of course it's hard to explain. It's just these things went together and I could see a narrative, mm-hmm. that was possible between these things, and I was interested in how by juxtaposing them I could do something, I guess, to my work or with, make my work go forward. So I guess that's how I approached the sort of the references and the narrative. And then I think I also view the process of making the exhibition itself as some kind of a narrative, mm-hmm. construct as well, in the sense that you build, you build spaces, you build specific moods, and then you can create tensions and things kind of negate, mm-hmm. or parallel each other. So that's, mm-hmm. I don't know if it's clear, but that's how
but
I see it.
It seems in this exhibition, and also in the exhibition at the Gnasher, that you're acutely aware of what happens when new bodies come into the room. So in your exhibitions, you can feel yourself, you can feel that there's a place for you. And I wanted to ask you about this exhibition, but prior to that, to ask a little bit about the exhibition at the Gnasher. So if you haven't been there, it's a really curious space. You have to go downstairs, and as soon as you're confronted with the gallery...
It's an aquarium, basically. Yeah. So you have stairs going down, and upstairs is a nice garden and a really gorgeous sort of modernist sculpture museum. You go down these stairs and then you're faced with a box.
And the box has got a glass wall in front of it. So it's almost as if you're looking into some kind of clinical zone, or you're staring into something else. And you immediately address that so that you made it.
Yeah, so it was my big problem at the beginning was the mm-hmm. window. I was sort of freaking out about the window and not knowing. And I had all these ideas about films and, cinder blocks. I mean, it was all about blocking the view. And then I came up with this solution of covering the walls with Vaseline. I mean, the glass with Vaseline, which blurred the view, yeah. and was also nicely physical. I mean, there's a lot of nice complicated associations with Vaseline, which mm-hmm. I really liked. So yeah, that mm-hmm. was that. That space was fundamental in a way, in mm. the way that the exhibition was conceived.
And it's exactly the same here as well. So I think I've probably come to see your exhibition, counting today as just one visit, even though I've been in and out all morning. So it's probably the fifth or sixth time that I've come to see the exhibition. And every time I've taken a double take, because as soon as you come in, there's a figure. And I know it's a sculpture, but yet when it's in the corner of my eye, I think it's someone sitting there. And the scale is really important. It's that physicality.
Yeah, because it's not a statue, because mm-hmm. it's not slightly bigger than mm-hmm. a human body. It's really the size of a human body. And the first figure that I made was a marionette, a life-size marionette. Mm-hmm. And I guess when I began making figures, I was obsessed with this Mike Kelly essay called The Uncanny, where there is a long discussion of the sort of primary or elemental origin of sculpture, and the idea that the first representations of the human body were made to be put in tombs mm. as surrogates for human beings. So there is always this sort of alive, not alive, mm. Real, not real, me, not me, with any figurative sculpture. And this is something that I've sort of kept coming back to. Mm. I mean, it's pretty basic, mm. but I think it's quite powerful. And then in Dallas, I had some figures that had masks like these. What I was trying to do is to create a spectrum of levels of realism, so that there were eight figures, and there was one that was entirely silicone. I mean, all the parts that came out of the clothing were silicone. so that it really, it was like a waxwork, sort of ultra-realist, a hyper-realist figure. And it was very uncanny, but then it was coupled with things, with pieces that were made out of ceramic, out of papier-mâché, and out of a and out of wicker. And there was a piece that had a body made out of wicker and a face made out of silicone like this, which was a very cyborgian collage in a way. So the show was very much about this sort of collage of materials and all the different ways that I could think of making these figures.
Mm-hmm. There's one artist who is often in my mind when I think about your work, Oskar Schlemmer. Is his work of any interest?
Yeah, I've looked at quite a lot of Schlemmer and all the triadic ballet and all the costumes. I sort of pilfered it for the Apocalypse Ballet works when I had these papier-mâché sculptures that had neon, that were either dancing with neon hoops or had neon hoops as dresses or as attachments in their body. And of course, I use a lot of black and white images from that period, and especially from his work, to sort of devise the costumes or the placements of the neons. But it's something about, because there's always I always think of the possibility of these things being animated in a way. So this one comes from a performance between a dancer and a life-size puppet that she manipulates, and the puppet takes on different faces throughout the performance. So it's also interesting to be able to play with that, and I guess the exhibition space is a stage.
I think so, and I think maybe that's one of the reasons why it does feel that there's a place for the viewer, for visitors, for the beholder, whichever word you want to use, in your exhibitions, because I think we almost become yet another player. So depending on the amount of people in any one of your exhibitions, things subtly change. So from where we're sitting, we can see all of you sitting down, and you're becoming sculptures, other objects that are part of this room. We look different because we're on this other side. When we finish, we'll all be walking around. It's that sense of your work being a part of the world rather than holding up a mirror to it.
Yeah, sure. I think where it became really apparent for me was when I did the Apocalypse Ballet, so the neon and papier-mâché figures in Chicago at the Renaissance, and it's a huge space.
Yeah.
And there were, you know, just a number of figures throughout the space, and this sculpture of a giant teapot that you could walk into, and it was very obvious that the visitors were like the figures were dancers and the visitors were dancers as well.
And I'd like to talk a little bit about objects, and after that I want to talk about sculpture, but first objects. And I can never work out the right word to use for the objects that you make. So I wonder sometimes if they're signs, but a sign isn't right because a sign is always pointing somewhere else. And with your objects, they're very present. They're in this room. I also know that they're not metaphors because they're not alluding to something else. Mm-hmm. They're not analogs. They're not standing in for something else. And I wonder, and I'm going to need to qualify this term, if one of your objects, or any particular one of your objects, might be a fetish. Now, I don't mean it in a surrealist way.
No, but there is this thing of either the fetish or the surrogate, or because I think I'm also from a generation where when you make an artwork, you also make the image of an artwork at the same time. And you know you have a sort of feeling for, say, the painting effect or the sculpture effect, and you know what it is. And in a way, it would be naive to just think that you can make a sculpture and it's an expression of what you know you do and that's it. And there's always in the back of every sculpture, there's all the other sculptures somehow that exist. And so sometimes it's a little wink-wink kind of, like an appropriationist type of thing. So I think this sort of ghost thing of, that you find in the work of, I don't know, Cheri Levine or a lot of artists from the 80s is something that carries a bit in my work.
But I wonder...
And in this case, this is really fetishes in a way.
Yeah, I suppose it's also this sense of I think that the reason why it's not a surrealist fetish is the surrealists were really interested in a degree of exoticization. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's what's going on here. It's also not a classic sense of a Marxist commodity fetish. It's something else, something that language will always do a disservice.
I think it's also this thing about what is it like? So there is an object, maybe an object that exists in the world, and there is a sort of fixation on that object because for some reason it's a punctum. So, for example, a Schiaparelli skeleton dress. Mm-hmm. And you're obsessed with that dress, and you think about that dress all the time, and that dress becomes a character. Mm-hmm. And then somehow that dress becomes part of a sculpture. Mm-hmm. So it's something like that. I think there are objects that are really, that have a special charge. And this is something that I think the viewer brings in and the artist brings in. You know, it's not only my objects, it's just the stuff that's out there in the world. There are things that somehow talk for some reason. And it's, and if you somehow, like when you make, when making the work, you try to bring that out or some, or, you know, or conjoin materials and, yeah, I mean, it sounds a bit esoteric, but it's something like that, I think.
I don't think it is esoteric. And leading on from that, when you're making an object, a sculpture, are you also trying to control the way in which it's going to be represented beyond the direct encounter? So one of the many things that characterizes your work, I feel, is you always seem to be, as the author of the work, completely in control of it, no matter how it becomes distributed.
Well, that's nice to hear, because I think there's a lot of, I mean, there's a lot of stuff in my work that's about a complete lack of control, because making all of these ceramics is this constant play of, oh, I'm making this, I have this idea how it's going to turn out in the end, but I have no idea how these glazes are going to work together, and I don't know what's going to come out of the kiln. Or, you know, like this wicker sculpture, obviously I didn't make it. I had a very amazing basket maker make it, and there's always this leap of faith of when you collaborate with people to make, which is something that's really important to me, is that moment when you go to someone and you say, okay, we're going to try, you know, can you make this for me? And sometimes it's co-making, because let's say I make but they fire or something like that, or sometimes I make on my, you make on your own, but sometimes it's a very hands-off thing. I do a 3D model and the thing comes out. So I think maybe what's controlled is just more, it's the narrative or the primary impulse.
Well, perhaps it's also embracing the possibilities of error or embracing accidents, because if one finds a celebration of accidents or things not going right, that actually places one in a much more controlling sense than refusing failure.
Yeah, I mean, it's much more it's much more liberating to accept what comes out. I always find that very difficult when I don't like a piece to just say, oh, let's get rid of it, for example. I always often sort of put them aside and wait, and just because sometimes you may like it better, or you may reglaze it and it would change. And I find it, because I find it slightly not my job to say that it didn't turn out right somehow, because because there's a recipe element to making these things, which is you have a protocol and you follow it. And then it's sort of your own problem if your protocol wasn't set up right. It's, I don't know, I think it's the sort of control and lack of control thing is very complicated.
So, very complex. So when do you know when a work is finished?
It depends when the deadline is for the show, I guess. I mean, there's an element of that too, of just realism. But I mean, generally, like for example, with these paper mache things, they're always wrong. I mean, the face always looks wrong. I mean, there's always something that's wrong to them. And if I tried to make them better, they would be worse in a way. And I think you have to admit that a certain level of it not being what you, friction or whatever is quite good. I think it depends on the type of work. I mean, like this is a thing. It's, you know, it's just technically so kind of perfect. It, you know, it's made and then it's there and you know it. But of course, with the ceramics, it's always, there's always the temptation to put another layer of glaze on it. And sometimes it works, and sometimes you mess it up.
Yeah.
And that happens too, I think. Over, I mean, it's like a painter's problem. This, oh, okay, should I mess it up a little bit? You know, continue a little bit. Let's improve it. And then suddenly there's water stains everywhere, and you've trashed it.
Yeah.
So it's.
Can you talk a little bit about your process of making? Because Early on when you started making work, it was very important to you that you were the maker. And then am I right in thinking that you then started to experiment with you still being the maker, but it wasn't literally your hands that would do that making?
Well, I made the early work, at the very beginning I made a lot of it myself, but then, for example, with ceramics, very quickly I had people help me. Mm-hmm. And when I did I did a show called 25 Sculptures of Pure Self-Expression, that was where I had my idea was make 25 black objects according to a list of characteristic of what self-expression would look like. And I actually had friends come over and make the works with me. But I was quite sort of dictated. I mean, I had lists of what they could do, basically. And then they sort of found their space and freedom inside it. And so I've always been interested in having other people make the work. And I'm not really, I don't really have this whole artist hand fetishism thing. I like the whole, is it Molinage, like ordering the work on the telephone? Mm-hmm. I find that, I've always marveled at that, that enameled painting that where he just said, okay, you call on the phone and you say, okay, take a piece of steel and bisect it and put red there and put blue there and then stick it in the oven and, bring it to me and it's done. And I think that's, that's just such a beautiful moment for modern art tonight. So, but then at the same time, I like the feel of stuff and I like to touch things and I also like to make things. So it's a sort of, some bodies of work I make more myself, and then some bodies of work I have more fabricators involved. With the ceramics, for example, it's really a mix. I share really with the studio.
I suppose it really depends on the work that you're making and what seems necessary.
Sure.
And the way you've just been describing this working process really underlines the fact that as an artist, and you may not agree with this, but I want to make a proposal here. As an artist, you always seem to be committed to making sure that the work itself is produced through the operations of society. And over the last few weeks, I've been reading a chapter in a book by Hannah Arendt called The Crisis of Culture that I'm convinced I should have probably read 20 years ago, but I haven't. And it's this amazing text where she's writing about the difference between entertainment and culture. Mm-hmm. She's claiming, and remember this is in 1961, if you think about the art that was being made then, this was pre her work on the Eichmann trials. Arendt is saying that the artist is the only individual in society. And she argues that every other kind of activity is never an individual activity.
When you mean when she means the artist, does she also mean the novelist and the musician?
She does. And she's arguing that this producer has the ability to confidently, importantly confidently, not arrogantly, place something into the world for discussion and to make a proposal for thought, rather than trying to make a law or a fact, or a new convention. It seems to me that when you're adding objects to the world, they're rubbing up against what we know already. And for one person, it might be rubbing up against the history of art. For someone else, it might be the history of ceramics. For someone else, the history of staging. For someone else, the history of fashion. For someone else, just being in the world. And it's that texture, that grittiness, that seems to me to give your work this incendiary charge. So when I encounter your work, I encounter it as being work that is built from wanting to claim that art has a stake in the world and it matters.
Maybe it's because I'm always sort of wavering between, hoping that art has a place in the world and, thinking that it's, being depressed about how inefficient it is, in the world, and also being, sometimes I also think that it's, of course, taking this sort of a Dornian type of position, mm-hmm. saying it's because it's not doing anything that it is doing something in the world. And so I guess it's things, I mean, but it's, you have to think of that. What, you know, what the hell am I doing? Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, who's looking at this and why? And also it's just a fact that it wouldn't make any sense if there wasn't culture. Mm-hmm. This is very, this is a very simple thing. I mean, mm-hmm. it's, mm-hmm. so, mm. yeah, that's my two cents.
I wanted to ask you very specifically about the sculpture that's towards the back of the gallery that is made of a series of white tiles. It's bodily scaled, there's water involved in it. It's something that is inviting, as with all of your work, multiple narratives. But could you talk a little bit about
that
work?
This piece. So this piece is, it's sort of the, again, the sort of conflation or meeting point of a number of like concerns or questions. Mm-hmm. And the first thing, I guess, was was hammam slabs. Mm-hmm. When you go to a hammam, you have these, like a Turkish bath, you have these large marble things, often 2 meters by 2 meters, where you can lie on and where they hose you down and they rub you. And I've always, I love these architectures and these spaces, and I find those spaces very special because there is this involvement with the body and your sort of, you know, the vapor and this weird intimacy mm-hmm. with the people that, you know, who are this very bizarre thing that you pay people to rub you. I mean, this whole, so mm-hmm. it was, you know, it was, first it was this hammam slab, and then of course, like, then it's like, okay, slab, all the types of sculptures that mm-hmm. work like slabs. And then, for some reason, quickly I thought, okay, this I want, and then this image of slightly monolithic block that had water running over it. Mm-hmm. So the hose that comes out of it, which was sort of the first thing, was like, okay, this thing is a fountain. It's like a, it's an object that has a revolving kind of course of water running over it. We switched it off, I guess, right, because it's not making any sound now. And because of my ongoing involvement with ceramic, I never thought of making it in marble. For some reason, I never crossed my mind that it would be marble, maybe because it would have been too chic or too mm-hmm. you know, fancy or whatever. I was thinking, so it was, then I got into all this ceramic thing and all this sort of bathroom material, basically. And then there were a lot of individual decisions that were taken in terms of the structure of the tiles, because mm-hmm. when I began, I had bought this reflexology mat. There is this trend for these mats that are plastic and have these sort of lotus-shaped flowers. If you go to like New Agey type of shops, you may see, have seen them. They're like these little plastic flowers, and the idea is like basically you lie down on this bed of nails, and it's supposed to do something really great to your system and make you feel better and make you feel no pain. Anyways, this object was quite fascinating to me because also this intersection of like it's relaxing but it hurts. And just a flower. So my initial idea was that the hammam thing would, I mean, the sculpture would have been covered with these flowers. Mm-hmm. And which, for a number of reasons, it was like the flowers were the wrong size, and it was too figurative, and it didn't work. I mean, there was like, it was like a, you know, it's typical. You have an idea, and then you try it, and then it just absolutely doesn't work.
Yeah.
And then we sort of resurrected with Niels Dietrich, the guy that mm-hmm. I make the ceramics with. I was sort of kind of rummaging around the glaze cabinet, which is something I do when I don't know what to do. And I pulled out a test that was all kind of rocky and textury. Mm-hmm. And it was like, what is this? And he was like, oh, that's an old test I made for someone with, you know, grok, which is the these sort of small rocks that you put inside the clay to make it, you call it in German, they call it Schamott, that you put inside the clay to mm-hmm. give it more body. And so basically he was like, this is normal glaze mixed with these sort of small rocks. And then I was like, okay, this maybe is even better because it has the roughness and the sort of this quality of being uncomfortable to the touch, but it's not figurative mm-hmm. like these flowers. And so this is how this piece ended up having this texture. And then there were a number of sort of decisions between handmade tiles and ready-made mm-hmm. tiles. And the fountain has zone has tiles that are a box standard, ready-made, 10 by 10 centimeters ceramic tiles for bathrooms. And these pieces there are made with handmade ceramic tiles. Mm-hmm. So I also thought it was interesting in the same show to have these two very different mm-hmm. materialities and kind of levels of making. So yeah, that's a little bit. And of course, to me now, the work is, it also quickly became about the things that you have in morgues. Mm-hmm. When you wash down, you know, a place where you could wash somebody, a body, whether alive mm-hmm. or not alive. So mm-hmm. that's, I think, what goes in there. And, you know, so I don't know if it's very morbid or not very morbid.
Well, surely, you know, to be alive is also to not be alive as well. So it's part of this continuum of existence.
Yeah,
really.
Definitely. But so you did this, yeah, this work was, it was all, this is really how it ended up here. Mm. Mm.
And there's a very beautiful thing that the artist Fred Sandbach often would say, that in an exhibition, every single work needs to be a good neighbor.
Yeah.
In this exhibition, all of these works are great neighbors with each other. So the two works that you've just described, that different texture, different way of making is really, really important. This work that we're surrounded by here is a very good neighbor to what comes next. So the making of exhibitions, that's very important to you.
Yeah, for me it's fundamental. I mean, to the point where I'll edit things that I like a lot because I think it doesn't make sense in the show. Because mm-hmm. I also started out as a curator, so maybe that's still somehow in the way of making the work. I think in a way, to me, you make it's almost like I make the work that I need to have in order to make the exhibitions that I want to have. So the space, yeah, somehow the show in the end is really fundamental, and the space, because I don't think I would have made some of this work without this this particular space, mm-hmm. like this curtain space. I think it would have been very, if the gallery had been a square, I think I would have dealt with a lot of things very differently. Mm-hmm.
And in this exhibition, there's two works that take the form of text that are new works.
The poem at the
end. Yes, can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so this was, when I was putting together the show, I thought it was so strongly, there was something so strongly narrative about mm-hmm. it that I wanted to have a text piece in it. Mm-hmm. And also, I tend to be a bit lazy with writing because it's hard, so I thought, okay, I have to really push myself and write one for this. And then I sort of was working with this sort of bare thread of a narrative about a sniper, a female sniper mm-hmm. who is looking for her friend, and her friend is dead and she can't find her. And it's this sort of lament of the friend, of the person who has lost their friend. And of course, it relates to the figure with the gun and this sort of narrative about war. The way I put it together was sort of also doing a sort of collage between sort of onomatopoeic mm-hmm. Kind of wail, almost like wailing, and some echoes of an older poem by Gustave Apollinaire that's mm-hmm. about that who that talks about dead swimmers in the Milky Way.
Okay.
So this all somehow ended up in this thing.
What are you reading right now? Given someone who is such an avid consumer of literature, poetry,
I'm at this point where I'm beginning two books at the same time because I haven't really mm-hmm. gotten into both of them. So I'm trying to read The Magic Mountain again, but it's so big that it's a problem for
and
flying.
It's so hard. It seems to take
yeah. So
a
this
month
is not
to
really
read one paragraph.
This has not really been very successful. And right now I'm reading a book by Octavia Butler called Kindred.
Mm-hmm.
I love Octavia Butler. I think she's mm-hmm. great. So.
I'd like to ask you just two more questions before I see if anyone else wants to join the conversation. The first question is one that I can never help myself asking artists whose work I admire a great deal. What interests you about sculpture?
Hmm. So it's such an abstract, I mean, it's just, well, so, a sculpture is in the space with you, that's mm-hmm. what I would say. Yeah. I mean, that's the simplest, sort of most basic answer, is that it's in the sculpture is in the same space than the beholder, whereas with painting, there's that window thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not so, I'm, somehow for me, it comes easier, this sort mm-hmm. of relating, you know, being in the, like you said before, being in mm-hmm. the world of the objects.
And mm-hmm.
I think a lot of the materials that I choose are also materials that have something to do with the world. So, mm-hmm. you know, this is terry cloth. This is what, you know, you wash yourself with, or you dry yourself with. And then this is ceramic. And ceramic is not just a sculpture material. It's a material of mm-hmm. pots and, you know, mm-hmm. things that you eat with, and yeah. also things that you shower in and that you piss in. And I find mm-hmm. that really quite interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Mm-hmm.
I would say it's with sculpture. It's quite easy to make this type of thinking to come alive. Mm-hmm. I think,
and it's also such a way of making art that's to do with the body,
yeah.
as well. And what could be more sculptural than being surrounded by something that you choose to dry yourself
yeah.
with? And then the other question that I want to ask before we open up is, can you tell us a little bit about where your thinking is going at the moment? So this exhibition is the culmination of a number of years research, always layering on what you're thinking. But where is your curiosity taking you to now?
Well, I think the two things that I really want to do at the moment are actually not really exhibitions.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, which doesn't mean that I'm not doing it.
Yeah.
Know, but I actually really want to do a book.
Okay.
This is one of the things that I've started, you know, thinking about a lot. Is a new book.
What kind of a book?
A sort of artist book catalog type thing. It's like how to take the work that exists and somehow, yeah, combine it into. A book. I mean, just making and a sort of book object, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
This and I also I'm thinking a lot about performance
mm-hmm.
still. So this is and I'd like to make new prints. Like I've been thinking about going back to doing printing again as
mm-hmm.
well. So these are sort of like new things, or things I haven't
yeah.
done for a while. And the book is also linked to the fact that I'd like to write more, and so. It's a good way to push yourself to write, is to think of a book format.
And when you're thinking about the book, are you interested in the mobility of books? So for me, I love books so much. I don't just love what's in them. I love having them in my hands, carrying them, having these incredible portable universes.
Sure, I mean,
beside
yeah.
me.
For me, I'm a sort of compulsive book buyer and.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when I made this, for example, when I made this book, which was 8 years ago, this was much more like made like an artist book, and then this book is much more like a monograph made with an editor who has
mm-hmm.
a grid, and you know you have to fit things a certain way in it. And let's say I'd like to make a book a bit more like this one
mm-hmm.
because it's been a while, and I think it'd be interesting.
Okay.
So that, yeah.
That's good. Thank you. Does anyone have anything they'd like to add?
Maybe to touch on something you talked about, this relationship of withdrawal and engagement, and I guess the narrative structure that you've got is a sort of a retreat
mm-hmm.
in some way.
Yeah.
I'm also reminded of a line that Ian Hamilton Finley said about Little Sparta, where he said gardening is talked about as being a retreat, where it should be talked of as an attack. And it seems to be something similar there, where maybe one retreats to gather strength, to gather force, to gather a sense of meaning in order then to do something with that. And I'm just wondering,
yeah.
as you may be imagining this project in the future, do you imagine it becoming, not necessarily, not activist, I don't mean like that, but you know, to have a sense of purpose in the world? Can you see it extending beyond this fictional space, entirely fictional?
I completely see what you mean about retreat and attack, and even on a personal level, as you know, someone who's also a political person and so on. So, But with the work, I always, I think it's great if the work says something, but I also think it would, I also have this feeling that it's a bit unfair to make it carry the burden of everything that's going on outside somehow, because you know, we can, I mean, because there's other ways of making politics than in your work. So for me, it's always, somehow I also think it's completely fine to make abstract paintings and not and not have the, you know, have the painting be a space of freedom, or you know, this sort of idea, had this idealized space, is also very important. And I keep going back and forth, so I think it's always going to be this tension between wanting to be involved or having to be involved, because you can't escape not being involved, because it's too painful, it's just too you know, it's just too much in your thoughts. And then this beautiful kind of you know, somehow pure, you know, kind of detached space. I don't think there's a way for it to be only one. I mean, with me at least, it's always kind of like, you know, mm-hmm. In out, or alone together, it's always like this. I think I doubt I will really change, but who knows?
And maybe that's shown in an exemplary way in the writing that you've done of this really importantly fictional community. If it became an enacted community, then it would no longer have the power that it has.
Yeah, it would be something else, and maybe not really my thing. This was a question people were asking a lot at the beginning. They were like, so are you going to start this commune? And I was always like, no.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Rebecca.
I really like this idea of your work as good neighbors, and I didn't know you had this background in curating Firth, and I think that makes a lot of sense that you really think about space and how your works fit together. But I wonder then how you feel about it, because obviously then when works are sold and go off into collections, you don't have that control. So does that frustrate you, or are you able to just let go of those and just look forward to the next?
There's two things. First, it's always really interesting when you end up in a new space with works that already exist and you can play with them, because there's always ways to recombine. So works become something else and become new in the new context, and that's true for my work or for other people's, you know, when you work with other people's work as well. And then in terms of what people do when they own the work, I'm quite philosophical about it. You know, there's been a few times when I was like, oh, okay, I would, you know, so, and if it's public space, or I mean, of course, there's things that I, you know, you try to specify that you can't do, or, you know, so for example, there was once a collector who showed me, and I don't even remember his name, who has a sculpture, and he thought it looked great with sunglasses. Yes, and I went to his home, to it was in America, I went to their home, and they were so sweet, and then he did this thing with the sunglasses, and I was just like, and I didn't know, you know, and I was like, yeah. And he was like, what do you think? And I was like, you know, I was like, well, you know, it's your thing, but it's not my work. You know, it's fine. You can put sunglasses in it, but it's, you know, when the sunglasses are on, it's your piece. And that's, you know, and I remember there was a curator of the museum as was working at that time, who's with me. And when we left, he was like, oh, you were so polite. And I was just like, well, what else could I say? It's like, I mean, it's in this guy's house anyways. And you know, he loved it enough to pay for it and have his dog bark at it every morning. So what can I do? I mean, God knows what people do with the, you know, I'd rather not know, you know. So, but it rarely happens, things like this, I think. I think people are generally quite concerned about what you want or how you want to show the work, usually, I think. I think it's quite rare that people do things that are completely horrific.
Maybe not as rare as we would wish, but it happens.
And sometimes they also come up with things that are that are fun that mm-hmm. you would never have thought of, mm-hmm. you know, juxtapositions of other artists or things like that, and that's mm-hmm. always very that's always very exciting. So.
But it's not only when a work goes into a collection as well. I'm sure that many, many artists have had bad experiences with curators where you suddenly find your work displayed in a way that you just think, what on earth are you
Yeah,
doing?
That happens.
But it's part of, it's very much part of that independent life of an artwork.
Yeah, I'm really quite philosophical about it. I learned a lot from my friend John Amleter about this, who's someone who, you know, will graciously smile when people hang a painting upside down. Mm-hmm. There's a really good story like that of Sigmar Polke. He I think he did a show in Zurich, and some of the work was upside down. And you know, he told the curator, he was like, by the way, that's upside down. And then he said, okay, and the curator was like, oh, we'll change it. And apparently he said, oh, let's just leave it the way it is and turn it around in the catalog. And that is just genius. It's kind of like,
yeah.
So that would be more, I mean, something to aspire to, I think, to be that kind of, the person who's that smart. Just be like, okay, yeah, okay.
But maybe to go back to Jeremy's question, that's almost the most powerful way that one can operate in a dissenting way is not to jump up and down and shout loudly. It's to just very calmly point out the situation.
It's just the fact that he made them turn it around in the catalogue was just so brilliant and so funny. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You want to be funny like that. I mean, in that way, you know, mm-hmm. I think it's great. So, yeah.
Good. So I think now is the time for me to say thank you, firstly, to the gallery for arranging this talk, but also to you for your generosity, not just in this talk, but also in this exhibition and in your work. Because I think I can probably speak for everyone in this room, your work does make a difference, and it's important that it's there. So thank you for
that. Thank you.